Welcome to Ralph's birthday, and thank you so much for making his dream happen. And his dream is to do a concert today for his friends and colleagues and family.
Yay!
And it wouldn't be possible unless you were here. So thank you so much. And we're also launching a new charity today because Ralph is a student and an admirer of Frank Sinatra. So not only is he going to sing for you today, but as Frank Sinatra was a wonderful humanitarian, Ralph also wants to make a big difference in the world and saving hungry children's lives. And that's going to be launched today too. Woo! And I love, you know, like we're launching. So we're all here for the man of the hour. And what a multi-dimensional man Ralph is. Sinatra's quote really has set the course for Ralph's life, which is never be scared of anyone or anything. And he also got that lesson from his dad, Maury, 95 years old. World War II war hero. Ralph lost his mom when he was 9 years old. He also lost a child who was 6 months old. And his life really became about overcoming adversity and perseverance. So many of you know Ralph as a trusted advisor, as a CPA, as an auditor, as a friend. And I want to tell you a little bit about Ralph as a husband, as a father, and as a stepfather. Ralph is so romantic that I just never knew romance existed like this. On a Valentine's Day, he made 30 little signs. I love you. I can't live without you. You're the dream of my life. You're so beautiful. And he like pasted them all over our house. And then after 5 years of marriage, he surprised me with a renewal of our vows in South Beach, Florida. And I'm not the easiest person in the world to live with, so I just thought that was... So, both Ralph and I are really about taking a chance on love, and that love can be better the second time around.
Yes.
Also a wonderful father, and he makes sure that his kids really feel his love and support and guidance, and he's right there to make sure that they know he's right there for them. And he has so much to give as a mentor that he stepped into the role, he rose to the occasion as a stepfather to my three children who never had a father and has really filled their life with stability and also mentoring and advice and guidance. And I can never thank him enough for stepping up to the plate in that role. I love you so much.
Yay.
And then today you're going to see another dimension of Ralph Picker. And Ralph Picker is a student of the American Songbook. He knows every lyric of every song that Frank Sinatra ever sang. He knows what year every song was written. He just studies Frank Sinatra. Like, we only listen to Sinatra radio. We watch Sinatra movies. So he almost channels Frank Sinatra. And you'll see what I mean shortly. You're in for a real treat. I've heard that when Ralph sings Sinatra, and he sings on cruise ships sometimes, or he'll sing in retirement homes, which brings so much happiness to the residents, that people will say, we feel like Frank is in the room. Also, I've really encouraged his passion for Sinatra. And I think it's interesting, don't you, that a CPA is such a musical talent. He just finished his first DVD, his first CD, and it's amazing. It's a 9-minute video that is so impressive. It looks like it's on PBS. I mean, it's first rate. So, anyway, this is Ralph's dream today for his birthday, to sing for his friends, family, and colleagues. Again, thank you. This dream would not come true unless you came through. So thank you for coming through. And I'll tell you a little bit about our plan for the afternoon. We're going to have lunch now. And then Mark Fournier, he's the co-founder of Raise the Bar, that you'll hear more about, which is a new charity to help stop children dying from starvation. Mark's going to talk briefly about the new charity. And then we have a celebrity guest that's going to be introducing Ralph for his performance. And with that, I just want to ask everybody to raise their glass. And let's say Frank Sinatra's favorite toast. May you live to be 100, and may the last voice you hear be mine.
May you live to be 100, and may the last voice you hear is mine.
Enjoy your lunch and the program.
Welcome again. Thank you so much for coming. It's my honor to introduce my buddy, Mark Fournier, and I want to tell you a little bit about him. Mark's going to only spend about 10 minutes telling you about something very exciting that we're doing together. And Mark's been a friend of mine for over a dozen years. He's got a passion to make a difference in this world. He's got remarkable skills in that area. I wish I had those kind of skills. He's the recipient of 3 Emmy Awards. He's a man who deals with empowerment of all of us in so many different areas, and he's, in my opinion, one of the geniuses that I've been fortunate to associate myself around. And it's very important that you listen to his discussion today about a new charity that we put together called Raise the Bar. It means something very, very important to me. I love children dearly. I had a 6-month-old child who passed away one time. Had a tremendous effect on me personally and emotionally. I've always been one of those guys who always plays with the kids and always spends time with children. This is one of the most exciting projects I've ever been involved with, and because we're getting far greater results very early in the game than we would ever imagine. The Emmy Awards that he received as a filmmaker to create a better world. He's the founder of this this new charity, Raise the Bar, and I'm the co-founder. And there's a related sister entity called Do Good Enterprises, because we'll be doing some other things through the years. So with no more fanfare, I'd like to introduce one of my best friends, one of the best guys I know. He's better looking than I am. He's authored many CDs, many books. He's put together an array of substantial literature on human empowerment. And so I'd like to introduce Mark Fournier.
Thank you, Ralph, and thank you all for being here with all those accolades. You'd think it was my birthday. I'll tell you. I would like to thank everyone else for being here. I'd love to spend the next 10 minutes just talking about Rel and the impact he's had on my life, the love I have for him, and the deep respect. But fortunately, we have some other wonderful folks like Janice to do some of that, so I can focus entirely on this brief little presentation, which will hopefully leave you feeling as excited as it did us when we found that there was something better. There was a better way of creating a better world. And what I'd like to do during these next 10 minutes is to help you understand a little bit about not just social enterprise, but why we believe that the social enterprise approach that we've taken is different. And why, of all the causes that we could have chosen, we ended up going with the feeding of starving and malnourished children. So before I do that, I'd like to first launch with a little video. The good news is, we've all seen what starving and emaciated children look like, so I didn't feel it was necessary to put that up on the screen. I think you'll approach that I've taken a little, or appreciate that I've taken a little different approach to this. And with that, I'll go ahead and play this video, and then we'll finish up with some information that I think will make a difference in your lives.
And let
We're hoping to make this a positive experience for everyone who gets involved. Even though there are darker consequences, we believe that we can make this exciting and fun, mission trips and all sorts of wonderful ways for folks to be a part of this. I know that we're eager to listen to Ralphie Blue Eyes, the maestro, performing as quickly as possible. So I'll just kind of buzz through some of the things that I think will really make a difference in regard to what you see in this opportunity. Social enterprise, how many of you have ever heard the term social enterprise? Okay, a few of you, it's starting to take on.
It's like the shoes. Like
yes,
shoes,
which yeah, we'll, I'll step into that shoe in just a moment. So yeah, I didn't invent social enterprise, but as a fundraising consultant, I immediately saw the power of this opportunity, because I don't know how many of you have, certainly I'm going to guess that every person in this room has at one time or another made a contribution. We're familiar with the conventional fundraising efforts and volunteerism and philanthropy, and many of you may even realize that over the past several decades, these systems have been failing. It now takes as much as 5 times the resources to gain as little as half the funds as it did only between 10 and 20 years ago. And I know because I was one of the guys they brought in to do that. But social enterprise stepped up and said, wait a minute, there's another way. We can make a difference in the world. In fact, Time Magazine said social enterprise will save the world. And the reason is because social enterprise pays its own way. Social enterprise is a business, but instead of its purpose being simply to generate profits, its purpose is to create a better world with its profits. But it pays its own way like a business, meaning it provides a service, it provides a product. We're familiar with, in some of the cases, it provides a service or a product that will in itself make a difference in the world, such as solar energy. That product alone can change the world. In some cases, they take their money and use that to change the world. How many of you are familiar with Tom's Shoes? Anyone? Tom's Shoes? Very successful. The idea was very simple. Buy a pair of shoes, we'll donate a pair of shoes to children who have no shoes, especially those in impoverished countries, where they can't go to school without shoes, where they get hookworms if they're not wearing shoes. Found out it could make a pretty big difference. Tom's Shoes took off, exploded as an organization, and their commitment and their ability to make a difference exploded. So these are some of the forms. Now in our organization, I would say that's what Raise the Bar does, but with a twist. We don't just want to, in our case, provide a bar. This is one of the things that we talk about. To feed these starving children, a micronutrient bar was developed. And this bar, for a regular human being, it's a meal replacement. You can use this bar to skip a meal, drop a couple 400 or 500 calories that day. It's a great weight loss tool. Very healthy. You can use it as an energy bar if you're in a hurry and you're on the run. Something that's extremely healthy in that regard. But on the other end, for a child who's malnourished, that one bar can be the difference between living and dying. It's all of the nutrition they need, not only to survive, but to thrive. And what does that mean? What does thrive mean? That means these children, their bodies and brains can grow by an additional 35%. If you've seen any of the images, any of the x-rays and so on, they show the enormous difference between these underdeveloped children. And so if their bodies and brains are growing, they become more disease resistant. Suddenly they can attend school, which leaves their parents the ability to now go back to work instead of caring for starving and dying children. And now the parents can generate more funds, which can help better nourish their children, who are now so well nourished they can stay in school long enough to develop a trade, go to work, and then take care of themselves and start properly nourishing themselves and their children. It's called a positive feedback loop, where one advantage creates another, which creates another and another. And we get to be the catalyst by simply starting with the most at-risk children and providing them with these nutrients, we can turn around not just a child's life, but their family, eventually their community, and all the way to their society with this feedback loop. And the numbers are coming in, and it's proven to be true and successful. And so our goal was to say, okay, so how can we get this food into their hands? Let's A, create a bar that people will use for their own purpose and say, for every bar you purchase, we'll donate a food product, a bar, or a nutrient packet to a child that will literally save its life. Again, we're not just making a difference here. We're saving lives and completely turning around entire cultures, societies, and communities. But when I said earlier that this was a social enterprise with a twist, it's because we didn't stop there. We didn't stop with, like Tom's shoes, buy a pair of shoes, we'll donate a pair. We wanted to make it so compelling that you just couldn't say no. And how do you do that? Well, everything being relative, by providing you with so much benefit that it is far greater than anything you could actually buy with the same amount of money. And so we started suggesting, wait a minute, they're playing the giving game with us. In fact, you've noticed this little book around here, The Giving Game. Well, we would like to, just as an example, play the giving game with you. Anyone who makes a donation today of any size, we'd like to give you an autographed copy of The Giving Game book. It was one of my first books. It was a bestseller, very well received, because it's a book that makes you feel good and inspires you to make a difference in the world. And it teaches you a dozen different wonderful principles and insights that you can actually use in your life. So we thought, well, that's a start. Let's take it a step further, and this will show you how we roll it out. If someone decides, well, I'd like some more of these, I want to play the giving game with others, so I'll buy more giving game books so I can give them away so they can play the giving game, and maybe I'll do it for the holidays. It'll be a great gift. Well, for every one of those, we feed another child. And so suddenly we've taken the model of buy a bar, we'll feed a child, buy a book, we'll feed a child, buy a CD, buy one of our courses, buy any product in our line, which is expanding all the time, we'll feed a child. Think of it this way. Think Amazon specializing in products and tools that empower, enlighten, inspire, and transform lives. That being our product line. But then you feed a child every single time one happens. This allows us to become so much larger and to reach our ultimate goal, 6 million children who are malnourished and starving, and our ultimate goal is to reach them all. And we believe that we can do this with this process beginning this evening. So we thank you for being here, for being a part of this, and I can request for anyone who's so inclined, these pledge cards, fill them out. Hopefully there'll be something there of interest to you. If you'd like us to contact you later for the final information, if you're not writing a check, if you want to use a credit card, just give us your information and we'll be able to do that with you after. We have some stations set up in the back. We have a card swiper, and we've got our donation button on our website, so we can help you do it that way if you want to while you're on the spot. But our main goal is for you to leave here feeling that there's a chance for you to make a bigger difference than ever before, realizing that it's not just making a difference. You're literally saving a life, saving a family, saving a community, and perhaps even saving yourself. So thank you, and I can't wait to see Ralph wrap this up for all of us.
James is in the house. Woo! So we've got, I told you I had some surprises for you. And who we have is, we have James Fashion Plate Payton. And who James Fashion Plate Payton is he dressed and he introduced Frank Sinatra for 30 some years.
Wow.
So, right? So I met this beautiful wife, Mabel, who's the president of the Streeterville Chamber of Commerce. And when she told me who her husband was, I was like, oh my God, he's got to introduce Ralph, who is doing a tribute to Frank Sinatra. So I just want to just give you a second of James's, he's always making history, James. And then he'll introduce Ralph properly, like he introduced Sinatra. So James dressed and emceed for Sinatra for over 30 years, also for Stevie Wonder, also for Aretha Franklin, also for the Fifth Dimension, and he's been on stages all over the world, Carnegie Hall, the Apollo Theater, and in front of the Queen of England.
Whoa, James!
He has pioneered in the music industry his entire life, making new pathways for future generations. He's always making history, president of the Platinum Productions. He's received the Men of Executive Award, the Courage Award, and the Red Carpet Master of Ceremonies. And with great pride and excitement, I'm so delighted to introduce to you James Fashion Plate Payton.
Hey, James.
So honored that you're with us.
Thank you, Janice. It's very nice to be here. You know, it's a long story about this, how we got together with my wife, first of all. It wouldn't be possible for me to be here without my lovely wife. Would you give her a big round of applause?
Yes.
I created something on my own years and years ago, and that's why I got the position that I did. I didn't want to be a part of the Temptations. I didn't want to be a part of Four Tops. I wanted to do my own thing. So I went to London, England, and I got certified as a gentleman's gentleman because I like to dress. That's my passion. And I was sitting in a club in Philadelphia where I would go every Friday night after work. And it was called the Sinatra Room. Everything in there was Frank Sinatra. And about a month later, I was going out in my job at that time, and a guy named Sid Marks said to me he couldn't work. I said, you can't work. Frank Sinatra's appearing at the Academy of Music tomorrow night. I said, I'll do your show. Never did radio in my life. Never. I lied. Purposely. So he said, well, you can go up there and see Joe, and Joe will tell you what to do. So I said, okay, I'll do it. He said, Jimmy, you really going to do it? I said, yeah, I can give the tickets away. So I went up there, and Joe said, when I go like this, you go on the station. It's drive time, 5 to 8. So I simply went. He said, go. I said, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's drive time in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, WAT Radio. Where's Joe? The phones lit up. And I went to the Sinatra Room, and I'm at the bar, and my best friend was Tommy Santangelo. His father was a great friend of Frank Sinatra's. And Frank Sinatra was appearing that next night at the Academy of Music in Philadelphia. And the guy walks over to me with a big cigar. See, your name James? I said, yeah. He said, man, you're good on radio. Somebody wants to speak to you. He says, Frank Sinatra. I said, get out of here. I said, Tommy, give me another drink. So he says, no, he's over there. Frank Sinatra and I sat down from 9 o'clock that night to 5 a.m. in the morning.
Wow.
Just talking. He fell in love with me, I fell in love with him.
Wow.
He had money, I didn't have any.
That's okay.
He said, do you want to come to work for me? I said, yes, sure. I'll tell my mother I'm coming to work for Frank Sinatra. Sure enough, 2 weeks later, I was in Orlando, Florida, on stage introducing Frank Sinatra.
Wow.
The rest is history. The rest is about me being with him in London, England, Queen of England, command performance, 72-piece orchestra. And there I am walking out on the stage saying, good evening. I'm James Pinkney. You don't know me, but when I finish, you'll know me. So I have my stories to tell, too. But when I, when Frank Sinatra decided that he wasn't going to do this anymore because he was sick, everybody, like Elvis Presley, came out of the woodwork wanting to do Frank Sinatra. And I would get calls and calls and calls. And I would very seldomly talk about Frank Sinatra because we had a confidential contract that I wouldn't tell stories about him. And this is the first time in over a decade and a half that I've ever seen anybody that I know that know Frank Sinatra such as Ralph does. And I've met all of them.
Right.
But it's only one other guy that can do Frank Sinatra, and he lives here in town. Mm-hmm. He works at Dickers, Johnny Vincent. You ever seen him? He's good. But when Janice told Mabel, and Mabel asked me, I said, okay, I'll do it. I said, because my wife is the reason I'm standing here today. Because I was diagnosed with multiple myeloma cancer, 2010, October 28th. I went into remission for a year. I came back. I was in the hospital. Oh my God. The hospital should have been named James Payton's Hospital. It's hard for me to stand up because I had two nails put here and a rod put here, and the cancer's going where it's supposed to go because nothing beats me. Something you can't get in Walgreens or CVS is a prescription of attitude.
Exactly.
It's God, my wife, and my doctors, and the rest of the people that support me. I will not be around a negative person. Because if you're negative, you only want company. If you're positive, you should spread it. And that's it. So I do a lot of things and everything, but at the same time, when I heard about this guy, we met at,
McCormick and Schmidt.
McCormick and Schmidt. She talks like, whoa. I mean, you want a salesman to sell you, there it is.
Yep.
So she told me about him, and when I found out, I'm going to hold on to this, do you mind?
Sure.
So when she told me about Ralph, I said, okay, I'll do that, because he, to me, taught me so much in life, Frank Sinatra. I never went with him when we traveled. I was always a day ahead of him, because he had people giving him private jets and everything, homes when he went on the road and everything. So I just want to clear up something. Frank Sinatra was never connected to the mob. He was just so suave and debonair that when the people went out at night, especially in Las Vegas, they went out in suit and ties. And I had that knack about me because I'm certified. And so I went up to him and I said to Frank, I said, let's do this. Never sing your hit song first. Always sing it about the fifth song. He said, what are you talking about, James? I said, I'll tell you why. I said, people are looking at you, first of all. I said, people are looking at you. They're not hearing you sing, they're looking at you. Let's change that white handkerchief in your tuxedo to a red one. I said, and I said, see this hat I'm wearing? I was wearing my fedora like yours. I said, let's get a fedora. The fedora, got a bench, put it behind us, and put the fedora on it. He said, what do you mean by doing that? I said, because when you get to doing My Way, which was written by Paul Anka, at a place in Fountain Blue in Miami Beach, Florida, on Diplomat, down the street from the Diplomat Hotel on Collins Avenue. And I said, you turn around, you put it on, and you say, I'm going to do it my way. Mm-hmm. And and that's how it all started.
Oh, that's so cool.
I did that, but I'm a certified gentleman's gentleman. I'm not a valet, and I'm not a groupie. I just did it my way. So at this time, it gives me a pleasure to introduce Ralph to you, to sing it his way, and his way will be our way.
Okay, I'm going to say a few words first. You know, each one of you is very special to me. There's some new faces here, some new clients here, some new friends here, some old friends here, and I appreciate all of you for coming today. I first want to thank my dear wife, Janice, for making this event today. Let's hear it for her.
Thank you so much.
And James Payton, what a press agent. Nice job. You are one classy guy, James. I do want to acknowledge a very special person here today, my dad, Maury. He's 95 and a half years old. He's a decorated war hero, and he's my hero as well. Dad, please stand, because I want to thank you for your service, and I want to salute you for your service. Some of you may know I have 6 children, 3 of which are my stepchildren, and they're over at that table over here. And I just want to say that I've been very blessed to be a father to all of them. And there is someone here dearly, one of my children here today. He was named after the flower, and I want you to give a nice round of applause for my dear daughter, Jasmine, right there. Dana, she's Papa Shy. Okay. I want to acknowledge a wonderful and quite competent employee. This is a surprise to her. She heads one of my firm's divisions. She is known to be the best hugger in town. She hugs the clients, and that's my best marketing plan I can ever have. That's Linda Smith. Linda, stand up. And I want to thank also Mark Fournier, my buddy, co-founder of Raise the Bar, who introduced me to the birth of this new charity, which will benefit thousands of starving children. Thank you again for your eloquent introduction and that amazing, amazing video. I am blessed to have a great career and a great life, but I really want to give my way of giving back to charity. So Mark, thanks for that opportunity to do so. Okay. Now to Frank. Well, there are many stories about Frank Sinatra. Some are fascinating, some are not so flattering. The trio always remains. He was the finest interpreter of the American songbook. He sang the best songs. He was a man who raised $1 billion for charity. And he was a man who fought against racial intolerance and intolerance of any kind. And he sang with emotional honesty, and I hope tonight I convey to you some of that emotional honesty. Before I start, I just want to say a couple things. I have many passions. I deeply love my wife, I love my family, I love my profession, and I love to sing. And I'm a very romantic guy. Today I'm going to sing mostly about love acquired, love maintained, and love lost. And my passion for Sinatra goes back some 40 years. What fascinates me more of the melody are the lyrics. And if you listen to the lyrics written by the famous songwriters, you'd be amazed at what they convey. And also, even right now, Lady Gaga is recording these songs. And Rod Stewart and many of the rockers are recording these songs. And why is that? Because they're fantastic songs, and they talk about stories of life and love and so forth. So I'm going to give you about 35 minutes this afternoon of the great songs from the 30s and the 60s. And I'm one of those guys who want to keep this American songbook alive. So I hope you enjoy it, okay? Okay. Now, my assistant for the afternoon is my stepson, Corey Alexander Goldman. Let's hear it for him. And this first song was the recording of 1953. It was after Sinatra had, really, his career was going down the drains. And he made the film From Here to Eternity, won the Oscar, and then this song was one of the first ones he recorded. And this song really illustrates how I feel today and now. Go. I've got the world on a string, sitting on a rainbow, got that string. I can make the rain go anytime I move my finger. Lucky me. Can't you see I'm in love? Life's a marvelous thing. Long as I hold that string, be a silly so-and-so. If I should ever let it go, I've got the world on a string, and I'm sitting on a rainbow. Got that string around my finger. What a world, what a life. I'm in love. Life's the marvelous thing. Long as I hold that string, be a silly so-and-so. If I should ever let it go, I've got the world on a string, and I'm sitting on a rainbow. Got that string around my finger. What a world. And this is a lie. Hey now, I'm in. Oh, now he's going. My next song is a song that Frank did in 1993, believe it or not, with Stevie Wonder. And it was a big seller because it was the last album he did. It's called Duets. Once in my life. Talks about my wife. For once in my life, I've got someone who needs me. Someone I've needed for so long. For once, unafraid, I can go where life leads me. And somehow I know I'm gonna be strong. For once I can touch what my heart used to dream of long before I knew someone warm like you to make my dreams come true. For once in my life, I won't let sorrow hurt me, not like it's hurt me before. For once I've got someone I know won't desert me. I'm not alone anymore. For once I can touch, this is mine, you're not gonna make it. Long as I've got love, I know I'm gonna make it. Once in my life,
got someone who needs me.
Here's a song that Frank stole from Liza Minnelli. It's, you'll recognize the song, it's from Cabaret. Maybe this time I'll be lucky. Maybe this time she'll stay. Maybe this time, for the first time, love won't wander away. She's gonna hold me fast. I'll be home at last. I'm not a loser anymore. Like the first time and the time before. Everybody loves the winner. Nobody loves me. Mr. Peaceful, Mr. Happy, that's who I want to be. For the outside, in my favor, something's bound to begin. Yeah, it's got to happen, happen sometime. Maybe this time I'm gonna win. Everybody, Mr. Peaceful, Mr. Happy, that's who I want to be. For the odds are in my favor, something's bound to begin. It's got to happen, happen sometime. Maybe this time I'm gonna win. I'm gonna win. You like that?
Yeah.
The singing account. Pencil by day, singer by night. Now, I was talking about love acquired, love maintained, and love lost. Here's a song about love really lost. Go ahead, Cormac. Let it go. Let it rip. Do I have to pay you for this?
Apparently.
That's fine. Hit him enough. Keep going? Okay. Once I could see, once I could feel, now unknown,
I become unreal. I walk the night without a goal, stripped of my heart, my soul. What now, my love? Now it's over. I feel the world closing in on me. Here comes those stars tumbling around me. There's a sky where that sea should be. What now, my love? Now that you've gone, I'd be a fool to go on and on and on. No one would care, nobody's gonna cry, if I should live or die. What now, my love? Now that it's over, I feel the world closing in on me. Here comes the stars tumbling around me. There is a sky where that sea should be. What now, my Lord? Now that you are gone, I feel a fool to go on. On and on. No one would care, nobody's gonna cry, if I should live or die. What now, my love? Now that it's over, there's nothing. My last goodbye. Bye bye. Yeah, wasn't that good?
Now here's a song about the moon. And in 1969, when the astronauts actually went up to the moon, Sinatra was saying he was there 2 days before because he drank so much and he was higher than a kite way up there. But actually, when they did land on the moon, the astronauts did play this song. So here it goes. Fly me to the moon. Let me play among those stars. Let me see what life is like on Jupiter and Mars. In other words, hold my hand. In other words, baby, kiss me. Fill my heart with song. Let me swing forevermore. You are all I long for, all I worship and adore. In other words, please be true. In other words, I love you. Song.
let me swing forevermore. You are all I long for, all I worship and adore. In other words, please be true. Some time ago, I wrote new lyrics for an old song about my dear wife, Janice. I rewrote the entire lyrics of the song, and it really demonstrates how I feel about my wonderful 5-year marriage to that beautiful lady. Come on, stand up, honey. Okay.
Thank you.
I'm not normally a lyricist, but I had a lot of fun doing this. And you'll know about it because you know her.
As for charm, hers is like wall to wall. She married me, couldn't have anyone at all. That's why Janice, she's a champ. She creates excitement whenever it's dull. She just appears, and there goes the lull. She merely smiles, and you're out of your skull. That's why Janice, she's a champ. She loves Chicago, even though it's cold and damp. That's why Janice, she's a champ. The next page is missing. Where did it go? She's a great friend who soars far above. She's that beautiful lady who you can't help but love. That's why, Janice, she's my champ. We all love her. She's one sexy gal. And she looks like 40. With few wrinkles, that's all. She married me, could have anyone at all. That's why Janice, she's a man. She was a free, cool wind in her hair. Life without a care. I'm glad I'm her lad. She loves her family, it's as plain as you can see. That's why Janice, that's why my Janice. Janice, she's my champ.
This next song I dedicate also to my dear lovely wife, and I change the lyrics as well. Yeah, I'm trying to teach my kids about this love thing, you know.
Romance.
Romance. Right, John? Oh, I love Janis in the springtime. I love your mother in the fall. I love Janis in the winter when it drizzles. Crazy about my Janis in the summer when it sizzles. I love Janis every moment. Every moment of the year. I love my Janis. And man, do I love Janis. Because she's here. Every moment, every moment of the year. I love that woman, man, oh man, do I love Janis, because my love, she's right here, she's here. Here's a song that was one of the last songs Sinatra recorded, and it's a ballad. It's about a couple who just couldn't make it, and it's a lovely melody and some interesting lyrics. And go ahead for a minute. I'm going to write a check for him in a few minutes, something like that. This is, by the way, one of my favorite songs, written by Peter Allen. Sunshine without rainy days. We wanted it always. You and me, we reached for the sky. Limit was high. Never. Deep inside, you and me, we're not like the rest. We once were the matter. Back when we were young, how did we become so smart and learn to break each other's heart?
side. You and me, we're not like the rest. We once were the best. Back when we were young, how did we become so smart? And learn to break each other's hearts. It
all. It's no good unless he loves you.
Than the tallest tree is. That's how it's got to feel. Deeper than the deep blue sea is. That's how deep it goes, if it's real.
When somebody needs
when somebody
you,
needs
sing, but I'm going to do it with Frank because the words really tell me about how I feel about Janice. Okay. another ballad. Very few I'm doing today. It's a song from Broadway, from South Pacific.
Younger than springtime, are you? Softer than starlight, are you? Warmer than winds of June is the gentle love you give me. Gayer than laughter, are you? Sweeter than music, are you? Sunlight and moonbeams, heaven and earth, are you to me? And when your youth and your joy invade my arms and to my heart as now they do, then younger than springtime am I, gayer than laughter am I, sunlight and moonbeams, heaven and earth am I with you. Younger than springtime am I, gayer than laughter am I, sunlight and moonbeams, heaven and earth am I with you.
Isn't that beautiful? Well, my next song I dedicate to my father Boy, 95 and a half years old. And it's a very appropriate song, and Dad, I'm going to go right near you, and I'm going to sing it right to you. Young and mine. to make it through 105, you know. And if you could survive to 105, you wouldn't think of all you'd derive out of being alive. And here's the first part. You had a head start. If you are among the very young, here's a song that Frank had in every single performance. It's about love. So deep, so very deep, it's under your skin. Almost done, don't leave yet.
Okay.
Got you under my skin. I've got you deep in the heart of me. So deep in my heart that you're really a part of me. I've got you under my skin. Tried so not to give in. I said to myself, this affair never will go so well. But why should I try to resist when, baby, I know so well I've got you under my skin. I would sacrifice anything, come what might, for the sake of having you near. In spite of the warning voice, comes in and like repeats in my ear. Don't you know, little fool, you're never gonna win. You choose your mentality, wake up to reality. But each time I do, thought of you makes me stop before I begin. Cause I got you under my skin. Who should I pick on now? Thank you, man. Why didn't we try to sit with them? Very. 15.
17.
I'm going up.
I would sacrifice anything, come what might, for the sake of having you near. In spite of the warning voice, comes in the night, repeats in my ear. Don't you know, little fool, never gonna win. Use your mentality, step up to reality. But each time I do, thought of you makes me stop before I begin. Cause I've got you under my skin. You give me under my skin. Okay, my final one. And I hope you guys will sing it with me. Very popular song. One of the last hits of Frank. And it's about the Big Apple, New York. And please, come on in, okay?
Okay.
Last song, okay? In fact, I might give the microphone to a few people. Come on, honey, come on up here, baby.
Yeah.
living today. I want to be a part of it. New York, New York. Being vagabond shoes. I wanted to stray right through the very heart of it. New York, New York. Come on, guys. I want to wake up in a city that never sleeps and find a king of the hill, top of the heap. These little town blues are melting away. I want to be a great big part of it. New York, New York. If I can make it there, I'll make it anywhere. It's up to you, New York, New York.
Honey, you want to say anything at all? Honey.
Yeah, honey. Like, wow. Everyone, I mean, oh, bravo. You rocked it.
Thank you,
honey. Oh, my God. You look, you, I can't even believe how amazing you performed today. I just, oh, my God. And I feel so much love from you and the way you entertained all of our guests and the difference you want to make with Raise the Bar, and I'm like your number one groupie.
Oh, right. Yeah! Yeah. 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 Too.
Thank you. Just beautiful.
Mark, you want to say something?
Yes, absolutely.
Wow, I love listening to this guy. Thank you, Ralph. Next year we'll bring in the real Celine Dion to perform with him, okay?
Okay.
Yeah. Thanks again, everyone. We are planning to just play some music for folks who want to stick around and dance a little bit, work off some of those calories, and for anyone who is interested in the details of contributing, obviously you have the pledge cards. Please feel free to drop them off with Mary. Beautiful girl here in the white.
Yes,
she is.
And for those of you who want to, we also have some stations in the back where you can just go hit the donate button. It's all set up at our website. We even have a card swiper. But if that gets too complicated, of course we take checks. Or just give us your contact information on the pledge card. And we'll be happy to contact you later. If you have more questions about the other things we're doing, how we in fact compensate those who have chosen to spread the word and share what we're doing with others. We give them all of our tools for free, and we even have a compensation program in case you know somebody who wants to make a living making a difference. So for anyone who wants more information, our website is raisethebar.enterprises. And then you can send us more information. Of course, you can reach us through Ralph. So that's raisethebar.enterprises. Be happy to follow up with you. We work with corporations, individuals. We train entire corporate workforces and feed the kids at the same time. So thank you once again. Please make sure you take one of our autographed Giving Game books with you. If you've made any donation at all, we'd love to have that go out the door with you as a gift. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Thank you. Yeah.